Hello YouTube, and welcome to another Elder Scrolls lore video. Today, we're talking about what transpired at Sotasil's Clockwork City during the year 582 of the Second Era, also known as the story of the Clockwork City in the Elder Scrolls Online. First of all, this video is going to contain major spoilers for that questline since I'm basically covering the questline. Second of all, this storyline is more or less a direct sequel to the Morrowind questline that I covered a few months ago, so if you don't know the contents of that questline, I really recommend watching that video first. It's in the description and in the eye icon right now. With that being said, let's talk about the Clockwork City DLC story. Our story begins, as I said, near the end of the Morrowind chapter DLC, where it's revealed to the player that the Daedric Prince Clevicus Vile, with the help of his hound Barbus, has discovered the entrance to Sotasil's legendary Clockwork City, a mechanical realm that the living god Sotasil himself created. It is revealed to the player that Clevicus Vile wasn't working alone, rather he seems to be working with multiple other Daedric princes in order to discover Sotasil's Clockwork City. Despite foiling Clevicus Vile's plans in the Morrowind DLC, his accomplice Nocturnal, the Daedric Prince of Night and Darkness, is still plotting somewhere out there and is now looking to invade the Clockwork City to obtain the living god Sotasil's secrets and, according to the objectives of this quest, change reality to her will. But your role as the player in this story doesn't begin there, as the schemes of the Daedric Princes are not known yet when your story begins. As your story for this DLC begins when you're summoned by Dvaith Fear, one of the most powerful, if not the most powerful, Telvanni wizard on Tamriel. He summons you to aid him in going to the Clockwork City in order to get the Daedric artifact from Sotasil. He's heard of your exploits in Morrowind and how you saved Vivec and foiled the plans of Clevicus Vile, and thus he thinks that you're the right person to accompany him to the Clockwork City. You and Dvaith Fear then travel to the entrance of the Clockwork City in Set's Vault. Everything seems to be in order as you two make your way to the city. But then suddenly, on the way to the city, Dvaith Fear is attacked by strange forces. This causes a strange dark aura composed of his power, which Dvaith Fear himself calls his shadow, to separate from his body. This made him lose a significant part of his power as the shadow essentially stole his power, and it rendered him useless in battle. This means that you two had to chase the shadow and you had to fight, as it goes deeper into the Clockwork City and tries to block you along the way. In the end, before you enter the main part of the Clockwork City, you catch up to the shadow, defeat it, and then return Dvaith Fear's power to Dvaith Fear's body. However, the incident with the shadow made Dvaith Fear worried about how such an anomaly could happen in Claude Sotasil's very much protected Clockwork City. It made him worried, and now he wants to hurry to the Brass Fortress, the Clockwork City's main settlement, to speak to Sotasil about it. When you arrive at the gates of the fortress, you first need to get a recommendation by someone in the city to enter. So, while Dvaith Fear enters the city, you do someone else dirty work and uncover some corruption in the local law enforcement, and then, after all, get your recommendation by Provost Veruni, one of the members of the Clockwork City's ruling council, which rules the city when Sotasil is absent or meditating. When you finally get your recommendation, you're finally free to roam in the city as you please, and you then go back to Dvaith Fear, who has in the meantime spoken to Sotasil about the artifact that he wished to have. But he then tells you that he thinks that Sotasil is behaving very strangely and rash, seemingly without thinking too much about his decisions. Dvaith Fear finds this extremely strange, as these are extreme opposites to Sotasil's normal behavior. Dvaith Fear then instructs you to go speak to the servants that directly work with Sotasil in order to discover what exactly may be going on. When you speak to Seal's direct servants, you discover that they are all respectfully annoyed by their master, as when he last emerged from his meditations, he suddenly started commissioning all sorts of random changes to the city, which made no sense to them, and seems to be driven out of impulse. But as they say, they're not really in the position to defy a living god. The most recent of Sotasil's changes has been to the lighting in the city. He commissioned citywide changes from bright and efficient light bulbs to far less efficient older type light bulbs. You discover these types of efficient light bulbs also emit strange types of invisible light, and the ones that Sotasil is currently commissioning don't. Dvaith Fear thinks that there's a connection between these older light bulbs that Sotasil suddenly wants in the city and Sotasil's strange behavior and why he suddenly hates the newer light bulbs. So he proposes a plan. You are to dive into the city's garbage to find some of the older lamps, while he tries to lure Sotaseel to the Congress Hall, where you two will illuminate him with one of the lamps that he wanted so desperately replaced by the less efficient lamps. It turns out that Sotaseel had commissioned all those lamps to be completely destroyed, so instead of searching for a lamp in the garbage, you're now searching for lamp parts in the garbage. But once you're finally finished fishing around in the garbage and found the lamp parts, and had the lamp reconstructed, you then return to the Vaithfir in the Congress Hall, where he lures Sotaseel to the center of the hall to give a lecture. While Sotaseel gives the lecture, you sneakily place the lamp as Sotaseel's talking and you turn it on. The bright light of the lamp shines on the living god, and the moment the rays of light touch him, he suddenly changes into a dark shadow, and you discover that the Sotaseel you'd been talking to isn't the original Sotaseel, but rather a shadow imposter. This sends the entire Congress, the people who lead the city and who had been listening to Sotaseel's lecture, into disarray as everybody panics about the fate of their clockwork god. You talk to one of the members, Provost Veruni, who suspects that the leader of the Congress, a man named Chancellor Gascon, is behind the imposter Sotaseel and that he used the shadow imposter to gain more power for himself. This theory of hers is strengthened when the two of you find out that Chancellor Gascon has fled the Congress and has retreated to his office as the Congress was in chaos. You and Provost Veruni then search his office only to find him gone, but only to find a Shrike, a Daedric servant of the Daedric Prince Nocturnal, searching in his office, searching for Gascon. When you kill the Shrike, it turns out that the creature had also been searching for Gascon, looking to punish him for some reason. You and Proctor Luciana, the captain of the Clockwork City Guard, then search the city but find no trace of Gascon. As you go through the city, you suddenly find that large talking crows are suddenly everywhere. Sotaseel's mechanical city doesn't have any living creatures, only mechanical creatures that the living god created. So these crows, for all terms and purposes, are alien to the Clockwork City, and Proctor Luciana wonders where they came from, as normally animals are blocked from entering the city and none has been seen since its creation. While the case of these crows is very interesting, you still need to find the fleeing Chancellor, which is a far more pressing matter at the moment. So, helped by a seeker robot, you follow his trail to the city and its outskirts, and then later into the Clockwork Wilds. As you follow his trail, you find that he has also been ambushed on his way out of the city by cultists of Nocturnal and more Shrikes. Almost all of the cultists are dead, killed by the Chancellor, but the few last living cultists tell you that Gascon betrayed them, as he would bring them an artifact in exchange for power. But at the moment that it was revealed that the Sotaseel that was walking around in the Clockwork City was actually an imposter, the plan apparently completely failed, and Nocturnal suddenly blamed Gascon and Clavicus Vile for everything that went wrong, and then the Mistress of the Night Nocturnal sent her cultists and Daedric minions to kill Gascon for his treason. Fortunately, as you continue to follow the trail, you get to Gascon before the cultists and the Daedric can get to him, and you learn from him that he tried to make a deal with Clavicus Vile to give him a key, and in exchange, Clavicus Vile promised that he would make the Chancellor the leader of the Clockwork City. The Chancellor accepted this because he felt that Sotaseel didn't care for his people, and that the Chancellor would be a far better leader who would be able to nourish Clockwork City far better than the one who created it, apparently. This key, however, that Gascon had promised to Clavicus Vile, was stolen of him by a big black crow just before Sotaseel's lecture, and when everything went wrong at the lecture, the key was no longer in Gascon's possession, and he had to run, because Nocturnal thought that he had betrayed them, not knowing about your involvement in foiling the imposter. After you get this information out of him, you can either choose to spare or kill them. He pleads with you to spare him, as he said that he simply wanted the best for his people. But yeah, the choice doesn't really matter, other than giving you more work later on when you kill him. When you return to the Clockwork City, it's decided that you will investigate the crows in order to get back the key that was stolen from Gascon. The strange thing here is that these crows are Daedric minions, and the black crows are minions that were created by the Daedric Prince Nocturnal. So the great mystery now is why Nocturnal was hunting Gascon for the key when her minions already had it, the crows. You track down one of the crows, which is sitting by the road, and you discover that the crows can speak. And in fact, many of the crows that you see in the Clockwork City are in fact part of the Blackfeather Court, which is probably my favorite faction in all of Elder Scrolls that 100% deserves their own video. Anyway, many of the crows that we see were sent by Nocturnal to fetch the key. But within her Daedric realm, the Everglome, there is actually a faction of crows that doesn't serve Nocturnal and that is independent of her. This group of crows pacified themselves from Nocturnal's control and are known as the Black Feather Court. They are a group of Daedric crows which hunt the places that they can go to for shiny objects for their collection, and they are organized in a feudal society with knights, rooks, fair ladies and the Duke of Crows, the biggest crow of them all, who rules over them. When the Duke saw that Nocturnal's crows had headed out of the Evergloam towards the Clockwork City, he and many of the men of his court actually followed them in order to see whether they could get more shiny objects for their collection in the place where the Nightmistress's servants were going. This is by far my favorite faction in the Elder Scrolls universe by far, and there will be a video on everything there's to know about them, I promise, but for now, this is all you get about their background. When you approach the crow on the side of the road, you discover that he is called the Knave of Rooks, a lower ranking member of the Blackfeather Court aristocracy. He confirms that the Duke's men snatched a very special shiny from the Chancellor and have added it to the Great Duke's massive collection. You can then request an audience with the Duke, but in order to speak to the Duke of Crows, you must bring him a shiny tribute. The Knave of Rooks instructs you to get a key from one of the watch captains and bring it as a tribute. You can then either convince the captain to give it to you, and so you can give it to the Duke, or you can steal it from his house, whatever your choices are in this game. No matter what you choose, when you return to the Knave of Rooks, he tells you that the tribute alone is not enough. You must also have a high-ranking member of the aristocracy escort you to the Duke and introduce you. So he points you toward one of the high-ranking members of the court who joined the Duke on their expedition to the Clockwork City, the Knight of Marrow. This great knight, greatest champion of the crows, then promises to help you and make you his squire if you help him court his love, Lady Blightwing. This fair maiden has rejected all shiny objects he brought to her, so you suggest that he should maybe read her a poem. Together you then travel to the archives of the Clockwork City and choose some form of poetry, which when you choose is all up to you. Once you have chosen a verse for the knight, he manages to successfully woo his lady love, after which you become his squire. Your liege then agrees to take you to the Duke, and the Duke receives you at his court and asks you what boon do you seek from the great court. When you ask for the key he has stolen from Gascon, he becomes outraged, but then gives you a proposition. If you help him fight against his mortal enemy, the Exarchs of Dross, enemy crows that serve Nocturnal and wish to take his shinies, then, and only then, will he give you the key he stole. Out of options, and no doubt out of great respect to the Duke, you accept their challenge and go out to fight the evil Exarchs. Really, all you have to do in this quest is shoo away some groups of crows. There's no combat, but as you and the Duke's men press on through the enemy ranks, the Duke instructs you to deal with their greatest enemy, the Motionless Guardian, a fearsome mechanical creature sent to destroy them. After preparing your gear, the fearsome battle is ahead. But once you scale the hill, you discover that this machine of absolute destruction is just a scarecrow, which you can simply knock over. I absolutely love this quest. This makes you the greatest hero the court has seen in many centuries and makes you an honorary member of the Blackfeather Court. But the Duke says before he can give you the key, there's one more thing that you need to do for him. You need to help him intimidate the leader of the Exarchs of Dross, so they will leave the court alone. You agree to help him, out of loyalty to the court probably, and then head inside the Clockwork City where a meeting with the leader of the Exarchs, the Queen of Chaff, is being staged. There you, in secret, control the Clockwork City machines from the shadows as the Duke speaks to the Queen. The Duke proclaims that he is now the master of the Clockwork City and that the Exarchs of Dross should get out and that the machines of the city listen to him. Of course, it's actually you who is controlling the machines through, you know, the panels on the walls. But the Queen of Chaff believes it and believes that the Duke is actually controlling them through his will. And she then officially concedes to the Duke, promising to leave them alone. The Duke is then ecstatic and decides to give you the key that he stole, which, to no one's surprise, is the Skeleton Key. A Daedric artifact which opens and closes all locks and had come into Sothasil's possession at some point. As you walk into the Duke's treasure chamber, however, you are ambushed by the Shadow of Sothasil and minions of Nocturnal. As the Shadow flees with the Skeleton Key, the minions attack you, the Knight of Marrow, and the Duke. You and your liege then bravely protect the Duke, but unfortunately, your great liege, the Knight of Marrow, perishes in battle. This is the final straw for the Duke, and in order to avenge his slain knight, he declares war upon the minions of Nocturnal, and vows to help you find the Shadow and the Key. Things, however, aren't that simple, as when you return to Provost Veruni and Proctor Luciana, they explain to you that the Shadow can use the Skeleton Key in order to get into the Cognitum Centralis, the place where Sothasil slumbers in meditation, the center of the Clockwork City. You and Luciana then go towards the Cognitum in order to stop the shadow from reaching Sota Seal, but you find out that the Cognitum's entrance is actually blocked by a barrier of dark energy in front of the Cognitum's Centralis, which has been erected by Nocturnal's minions. You and Luciana then find out that the barrier is being sustained from Nocturnal's realm by her minions, from the Everglome. In order to destroy the barrier, you two will need to enter one of these portals into the Everglome and kill whatever is sustaining the portal in order to get into the Cognitum and save Sota Seal. Now, here comes the point where your choice on whether or not you killed or spared Chancellor Gascon matters, as he had collaborated with the Daedra cultists and thus he knew of the places where they sustained their portals. You can then either interrogate him if you kept him alive, or use Clockwork City technology to mine the dead memories of his body, and then retrieve the location of the portals into the Everglome. With the help of the Blackfeather Court, you are then able to enter the portals, as only Nocturnal's cultists and her creatures are able to pass through the portals. With the help of the Knave of Rooks, you then manage to find and kill the Daedric minion sustaining the barrier, and then using a spell that Sota Seal once taught Proctor Luciana, you manage to break the barriers and head into the Cognitum Centralis, once you enter the Clockwork City again. You then venture through the Cognitum and fight your way through the defenses of the Cognitum and its protector, the AI called EOS, which is made by Sota Seal to guard his Star Slumbering Place. When you reach the central chamber, you find that you're almost too late, as the shadow is siphoning away Sota Seal's power by keeping his body stuck in his meditation machine, which is locked with the skeleton key so that Sota Seal can't get out. You then fight the shadow and defeat him, but the shadow then attempts to flee with Sota Seal's power in check, but before he can flee, the Vaithfear barges in through a portal and keeps the shadow in place using a spell, calling upon you to quickly free Sota Seal from the machine. When you turn the skeleton key and free Sota Seal, the Clockwork God quickly disintegrates the shadow and reabsorbs the power, thanking you for what you did for him. You can then ask him for a reward for saving him, which is either heal Proctor Luciana, who got badly hurt during the battle with the Shadow, or gain an XP bonus for the day. I did not go for the XP bonus, because that's not a very good reward. After sorting out some business with the Clockwork Congress about what happened, he asks you and the Vaithfear to meet him at a monument out in the Clockwork Wilds. This is the same monument which holds the projection of his sister, which I covered in my last video. Link in the eye icon if you haven't seen it, and in the description. He then tells you that while you managed to foil this plot and Clefica's Vile's plot in Morrowind, these two Daedra were working with Mephala, who has now set her sights on the Somerset Isles. He gives the Vaithfear the skeleton key for safekeeping, and Sota Seal then tells you to go to the Somerset Isles and stop what's about to happen there, which I will cover in a future video. Cliffhanger. Alright, this was a pretty long video, and I'm glad that I was able to cover this questline. In terms of story, it's really good, but in terms of gameplay, it wasn't too great, since a lot of this questline is just basically running around, collecting worthless things. Basically feels like a lot of padding and listen to dialogue. There are some fun parts, but most of it was relatively boring from a gameplay perspective, so I was glad I was able to make this video so that you guys only get the story part, which is, in my opinion, pretty good. Because I actually love the story. That being said, if you aren't still sick of hearing my voice yet, I recently made a cameo in another lore video from my fellow lore YouTuber Kuyo. The video is on Oblivion and its realms, and it goes further into the metaphysics than I usually go, so if you're interested in that kind of lore, the video is in the description of this video, and I can very much recommend giving it a watch, as the lore in it is pretty interesting. If you aren't interested in that video, then maybe consider for returning for the next lore video on this channel next week, or perhaps watch some of my older videos, because I made a lot over the years. Before I end this already long video, allow me to thank my top patrons, Mr. Bernardo Binda, Gabriel Binda, and Mr. Christmas. These wonderful people, along with all the others on screen, put me in the position to make these kinds of videos, and for that reason, I'm very grateful. With that said, I'll see you all in the next Elder Scrolls lore video, probably on the Blackfeather Court, because I love my brethren, or the Elder Scrolls Legends Clockwork City questline, because I've also been documenting that and researching that. Alright, see you next time. Bye-bye.